Hello everybody and welcome to video number 27 of the online version of the Fusion Research Lecture. We are in chapter 5, collisional transport, and in the last video we started to look into neoclassical transport, that is transport in the toroidal or due to a toroidal magnetic field geometry, and we looked only at transport resulting from passing particles. Now we will look also at trapped particles. So we are still dealing with neoclassical transport. Neoclassical transport. And this time we will look at trapped particles. Trapped particles. Now, you might not be surprised by that, but particles trapped in banana orbits reside in increased transport. So banana orbits result in somewhat increased transport, increased due to as in comparison to the passing particles. Now, it is now important to note that there can be a transition from banana particles to passing particles by small angle collisions. So particles, so we have to look into this transition region as well. So particles can change from a banana orbit into a passing particle. Now how might that look? Let's make a simple drawing for that, a sketch rather. Two axes, maybe something like this, where here we have the parallel velocity and then we have the magnetic field strength, maybe looking like this. Down, up again. So this is supposed to be B, the magnetic field strength. Then here we are at zero on the output side. So this is the poloidal angle theta. Then here where the maximum is, we have minus pi. And accordingly here, this would correspond to plus pi. And now having a particle sitting here with that parallel velocity, it would mean that this particle is trapped. So it travels in this direction and then it bounces off the magnetic field and so on and so on. So this would correspond to a trapped particle. Now a passing particle would have a velocity, a parallel velocity somewhat larger, for example sitting here, and then it could just pass around, being a passing particle. And by a collision which changes the parallel velocity just a little bit, increases this, a trapped particle can transit into a passing particle. And just a reminder, when we look at our typical poloidal cross-section, then a banana orbit might, might look like this, for example, in the poloidal projection, you remember this. Then the width here, so this is supposed to be more or less the same. This width, this distance corresponds to the width of the banana orbit, which we will use as step size. Okay, so before looking at one particle which transits from one being trapped to being a passing particle. First, the obvious thing is that we will again describe the transport with a random walk process, where the random radial motion corresponds to has a step size of delta BA, which is the banana width. And as a reminder, this was the poloid Lama radius times the square root of epsilon, or the width of a passing particle of the displacement of the drift plane with respect to the flux surface is divided by the square root of epsilon. Now there is an important thing to note, as I said two times already, the step size is different from the collision time as we have usually defined it. So now the step time for this case is different from the collision time, which is defined for a 90 degree collision, because here we are looking at smaller angles. Here we are looking at smaller angle, which transfers, or kicks if you want, which transfers the trapped particle into a passing particle. And that angle is much smaller than 90 degrees. This is much smaller than 90 degrees. Well, small angle, let's write it, make a more or less proper sentence. A small angle transferring the trapped particle into a passing particle is actually much smaller than 90 degrees. Now, instead of fully deriving it, I just again outline the steps. So using the conservation of kinetic energy, that is 1/2 mv squared, and in addition the conservation of the magnetic momentum, something which you know from the discussion of the magnetic mirror that was used to derive the trapping condition, mu mv per squared over 2 times the magnetic field. And from these two conditions, we can, or using these two conservation laws, we can derive estimated trapping condition V parallel at the outboard side, this is why you say zero there, over V perpendicular at the outboard side has to be smaller than the square root of 2 times the inverse aspect ratio. And that allows us then to write down a correction for the momentum relaxation time. So I'm using this type of arrow here to indicate that this involves a bit of a algebra as well. So the momentum relaxation time needs to be corrected. And it needs to be corrected by the ratio of the small partial of the small momentum change compared to the 90 degree change. Yeah, so the ratio of just a small angle change to a 90 degree change. And then the effective collision time, we call this an effective collision time, can be given and approximated, which is tau effective is equal to tau ei times epsilon. Okay, so this is the effective collision time which we will use here. Now let's first look, or we have to distinguish two more cases, and the first case is again like in the previous example where we looked at passing particles for a long collision time. So for little collisions happen. So if we have long collision times, this means that tau effective which is given by the electron ion collision time times epsilon, as I've just said, is larger than the banana time, which was given by the transit time over the square root of epsilon. And we can rearrange that such that we can write that tau transit over tau electron ion is actually smaller than epsilon to the power of 3/2. So this is the condition of, or if this is fulfilled, we speak of long collision times, and we call this regime which we are in then the banana regime. Yeah, so this is the banana regime, and there the effective collision time is larger than the reflection time of the bananas, as it's written at the top. Yeah, so basically means that the effective, doesn't hurt to write it down again, that the effective collision time is larger than the reflection time of the banana orbits, and the reflection time of the banana orbits. I'll just write bananas here. Now, since we now have also a collision time, so a step time, we can define a diffusion coefficient of, as an example of electrons in the banana regime. So we can define a diffusion coefficient, or derive a diffusion coefficient of electrons in the banana regime. And that is d banana approximately the width of the banana orbits as stepping size, as step size. And we use 2 times tau effective for the stepping time. And then we also account, we multiply with the square root of epsilon, and this is to account for the fraction of trapped particles. As you remember, the square root of epsilon is approximately, corresponds approximately to the fraction of trapped particles. The fraction of trapped particles. Trapped particles. Now, inserting for the banana width, we can then write, first of all, let's bring the square root of epsilon to the front, and then insert, then we have mv over e times b theta times the square root of epsilon, and this squared times 1 over, and then now for tau effective, we insert 2 times tau electron ion times epsilon. And if we have a close look at this now and remind ourselves of the last video, we see that the diffusion coefficient for the Fisch-Schlüter regime appears here. So we have 1 over, first of all, the epsilons. This is epsilon to the power of 3/2 times the diffusion coefficient for the Fisch-Schlüter regime, which means that in the banana regime, we also have a scaling, a linear scaling with the electron ion collision frequency like we had in the Fisch-Schlüter regime, but it is larger than the Fisch-Schlüter regime due to this additional factor 1 over epsilon to the power of 3/2. Okay, so an increase as compared to the Fisch-Schlüter regime. Now, when the collision time increases, a transition occurs. Okay, so a transition occurs, and this transition occurs when, well, when the collision time decreases, when it is epsilon, when epsilon 3 half is smaller to the power of 3 half is smaller than the ratio of the transit time to the electron ion collision time being smaller than 1, then we have no longer full complete, or well, closed, I should probably say closed banana orbits, which means that we have a reduced step size. So we get a reduced step size, but the number of collisions increases. So two counteracting processes, so a reduced step size, but also the number of collisions increasing. And this means that the diffusion coefficient D is approximately constant here. And this is why the corresponding transport regime is called the plateau regime. So this corresponds to the plateau regime. And in this regime, we can make an estimation that the effective collision time corresponds to the banana time, which means basically that we have just one banana orbit, and then the diffusion coefficient in the plateau regime can be estimated by again the square root of epsilon to account for the trapped particles, and then it's the banana width over the 2BA, the banana stepping time, the transit time for the banana particles, sorry, and then inserting, then we get that the square of the delta P, the displacement of passing particles over 2 times the transit time. And this then can be written further as 1 over iota bar squared times the Larmor radius squared over 2 times the transit time. And the main point, however, is, as I said, that it does not scale with the, that it does not scale with the electron ion collision frequency, meaning scales with the electron ion collision frequency to the power of 0. Yeah. Now, what happens when the collision time further decreases? So if we have the case that the electron ion collision time is approximately the same as the transit time, then we have practically no banana orbits anymore. We have practically no banana orbits, or let's say banana particles anymore. And what then happens is we have a transition into the Pfirsch-Schlüter regime. So we have a transition into the Pfirsch-Schlüter regime. Okay. So now we have everything together for the neoclassical diffusion coefficient in the tokamak. We have passing particles and we have trapped particles, and we have distinguished depending on their collisionality of the particles, on the collision frequency. So let's have a look how it looks if we combine everything together. So let's look at the neoclassical diffusion coefficient in a tokamak. Now let's first draw the coordinate system. Let's make it a bit larger, like this. Then into this direction, maybe like this. So the vertical axis is D, the diffusion coefficient. The horizontal axis, we have the transit time over the electron ion collision time being proportional to the electron ion collision frequency. Okay, so let's start first with the banana regime. So the banana regime, it starts somewhere here, maybe up to here. Then what we have here is a position where epsilon, where the transit time over the electron ion collision time corresponds to epsilon to the power of 3/2. This corresponds here to the banana regime. So this is the banana regime. And in this regime, the diffusion coefficient can be approximated by delta BA squared, so the banana width squared over 2 times tau effective times the square root of epsilon. Next, we have the plateau regime. As I said, the plateau regime, the diffusion coefficient is constant as a function of the frequency, of the collision frequency. And it stops roughly where we have a ratio of the transit time to the electron ion collision time of 1, which means that at this position, we have practically no bananas anymore. This regime is called, as I said, plateau regime. This is the plateau regime. And the diffusion coefficient, the plateau regime, is given by delta BA squared over 2 times tau, and then the banana time times the square root of epsilon. And then finally, we have the Pfirsch-Schlüter regime. Goes approximately like this at first, and then in the end it continues to decrease again. So this is the Pfirsch-Schlüter regime. The Pfirsch-Schlüter regime, where the diffusion coefficient is first in the linear increase region given by the Pollard-Lama radius squared times epsilon squared over 2 times the electron ion collision time. And of course, this can be, this increases linearly if we would extend this to something like this. And then if we were to include the classical diffusion coefficient here, this would look something like this. So a linear increase, but being much, much smaller. So this is actually a bad scaling here. This is not two scales. It would be much smaller, actually, as you remember from the lecture where I said it is a factor of 20, at least smaller. So this is the classical diffusion coefficient, where it is given by the Lama radius squared over 2 times the electron ion collision time. Okay, that's it for this video, where we looked into trapped particles and how they contribute to the neoclassical transport. We distinguish between particles which experience almost no collisions, so they stay in their trapped banana orbits, particles which experience some small angle collisions, thus can transit from being trapped to passing particles, and particles which transit, which experience a lot of collisions, so they are in the Pfirsch-Schlüter regime. And in the end, we get a full neoclassical diffusion coefficient in a tokamak, as shown on this plot, where we have 3 different regimes: the banana regime, the plateau regime, and the Pfirsch-Schlüter regime. In the next video, we will look into what changes in the stellarator. But for this video, that's it. See you in the next video.